Thank you for joining us wherever you are. This podcast episode is brought to you by the Old Ways Actual Play Team. This actual play uses the 7th edition Call of Cthulhu tabletop role-playing game rules by Chaosium. This actual play is performed by adults and in an adult setting. While we try very hard to stick to language for all ages, listeners should know that this podcast may include mature themes. All content, including names, places, events, companies, and etc., that may bear resemblance to entities living or dead, is strictly coincidental. My name is Michael Diamond, and for tonight's game, I will be your keeper. Thank you for joining us again. Another episode of the Old Ways Podcast. I'm your keeper, Keeper Michael. We return to our Horror on the Orient Express campaign with a slight deviation, because we are going to introduce a couple of new investigators. And so I will kind of get out of the way and let them introduce themselves. So to my right.
Hi, I'm Miranda, and tonight I will be playing, as many know her, Madame Davina. She is a tea leaf reader, a palm reader, fortune teller extraordinaire.
And then joining her is...
Hello, I'm Mike, and tonight I shall be playing Aidan Moore, who is an agency detective in the employ of Palaki's Detective Agency of London.
Splendid. So, if you would, Miranda, give us a bit of an overview as to the character and where maybe a bit on what their days are like this today. You can be as secretive or as open as you choose.
Yes. So, Madame Davina travels a lot, sometimes by her choice, but not always by her choice, as mystics and reading tea leaves. While popular in some circles right now, in other places, you'll be likely to be run out of town, which is what brings me to London from the States. She makes enough money to get by. She does spend her day reading fortunes out of the back of antique shops that her friends own. And sometimes she will stay there, but other times she will stay in long-term lodging. So she spends her day socializing with her friends, studying various interesting occult objects that they may have recently gotten their hands on, and then reading fortunes in her spare time for a little extra cash, sometimes going to parties even, because that's where you can really rake in the dough.
Yeah, you gotta, you know, get one over on the uninformed and, you know, go on to the next town.
Yeah, or stick around.
Maybe share something very important with them. You never know.
Yeah, I think she inherently wants to help people, and sometimes the best help you can give people is a little bit of hope.
Yeah, I'd say that's fairly certain. All right, so tell us a little bit about Aidan then.
Yeah, so Aidan Moore was born in Armagh, in what is now Northern Ireland. He grew up in a tenant farming family there. He served in France during the war, which is in fact where he first met Corporal James Fraser. On his return after the armistice, he joined the Metropolitan Police Force in London, and after a few years walking the beat, he left to join Palaki's detective agency, where he's been for just over 2 years or so. He's married to Eileen, who's a housemaid, and he lives with his wife and their two small children, Patrick and Grace, in South London.
And your cases as a private detective, any specific highlights maybe, or most interesting cases you've covered so far?
Well, Aidan's still a junior at the agency, so he's mostly assigned to smaller cases, surveillance and the like, and cheating husbands and wives and that kind of thing. However, there was a case not that long ago, a jeweler's in Camden, where a rather expensive necklace had been stolen. After a little bit of digging, he discovered that the shopkeeper, the owner of the jeweler's, had amassed quite substantial gambling debts with a local, rather disreputable bookmaker. And it turned out that what he'd done is he'd pawned the necklace himself and also claimed on his insurance in order to pay off these debts. He spoke to the man and he admitted what he'd done, and the case was cleared up. Also, not long after that, in fact, he was asked to look into the case of the missing daughter of a businessman. After making some inquiries, he discovered that she had, in fact, eloped with one of the servants, and he tracked them up to Scotland, where they were planning on getting married. After confronting them about the situation, it became apparent to him that the girl's father was somewhat domineering and had been dead set against this marriage because he considered the servant to be a gold digger and only interested in his daughter for her money. But they did appear to be genuinely in love, and as far as he could tell, and he's a pretty good judge of character, the servant's intentions were entirely honourable. So in this particular instance, he returned back to London and reported that he had not in fact been able to catch up with them until after they had been wed. And as she was now married, his hands were tied. The father was, of course, absolutely furious about the whole situation, but there was not a lot he could do.
Very well. Good to know. So for reasons we may yet uncover, the both of you have been, I don't know if invited is the right word, I would say alerted to a soiree going on one afternoon in, say, the middle of February, 1925. So Madame Davina has been made aware that an Esther Beaton, Esther Jane Beaton, a very important socialite in some of the London circles, has been putting out feelers for people with your talents. Her plan is to collect a room full of diviners and those practitioners of occult searching, because she is desperate to contact her late mother over a matter of some import. You'd heard about it from a friend of yours in Soho, and they have implied that they can help get you in to this very fancy soiree where you might be able to make a couple weeks or more of pay for just a night's work.
Yeah, I would definitely be interested in pursuing this, partially for the cash, but also maybe to see if there is some sort of strengthening of the psychic energy. If she's getting this many people in one room together, I kind of want to see what that's going to do. So I would definitely be in on this.
Yeah, word is it could be as many as 20.
Yeah, and I have definitely not seen that many people gather together focusing their abilities at one time. If these people truly have abilities, I'm very interested to see what we can do, and maybe we can bring some peace to this old lady.
And likewise, Mike, Aidan has been creeping along for the past couple of weeks now, hunting down the tendrils of this Fitzgeorge case. It is something that you've been desperate to get more information on. And while you were in central London, you'd heard that you'd heard from one of the law clerks that you'd been questioning back and forth that there was a sighting of him near the Beaton residence, and that he'd been spending quite a bit of time there. And so maybe without any foreknowledge at all of this soiree going on, it becomes clear to you that it's going to be your next point of investigation.
Yeah, I think in the first instance anyway, I'll probably spend a little bit of time scoping the place out, watching the comings and goings, getting an idea of who the servants are, what their movements are, that kind of thing. I might even see if I can speak to one of the servants at some point in a less, when they're on their break, or you know, on their evening off or a day off or something like that, just maybe kind of see if I can get a chat with them to find out what their employers are like. Just basically use a little kind of them and us psychology on them.
Sure. That's not probably too hard. You have more than a few opportunities to catch a, whether it be a footman or whether it be a member of the kitchen staff as they go out to get items for various meals.
I think member of the kitchen staff, definitely. They'll know exactly what the strengths and weaknesses of the people who come to the house are.
Yeah, so the impressions you'd probably get from a member of the kitchen staff are that the Beatons are, on balance, a decent family to work for. The two younger girls are mostly a joy to be around. Baba, the younger one, is a little needy sometimes, but she's young yet. Nancy is beginning to come of age, and she's, you know, learning what it means to be a member of a higher society, and so there's been a lot lumped on her as the eldest daughter. They do say that the house has been fairly cold as of late. They feel like something has gotten to Ernest's mind. He's very, very distant lately, and the staff's not sure why. Some people think maybe it's a post-war melancholy or something to that effect. Maybe he's wrapped up too much in the timber business at this point. But to that end, they would note that Esther's been the exact opposite. She's been wildly social. She has been uncharacteristically excited to go to social events, to have people over. One, the member staff probably would say something that she's been nearly affectionate. Not in an undue way, but as something that would not normally be the same sort of staff versus family relationship. Almost too familiar. And they would mark that with you, that it seemed a little strange.
And has this been going on kind of for about the same period of time as Ernest's rather more distant manner?
Yeah, they seem to remark that it does go on about the same time.
The eldest daughter, Nancy, is she of marrying age?
Let's see.
Is she a little young for that yet?
She would be 16.
All right.
Maybe. Almost 16.
Maybe a little young, just possibly. So I suppose the next question I've got is, do I know that if Fitzgeorge has already paid visits to the house?
If you ask the member of staff that you meet there in the market, they would remark that there has been a man about on call from somewhere, they say, in the east. They said they think he's Italian or maybe Greek. He definitely doesn't. They would say he's not from around here. They definitely would remark something to that effect.
Who is in London?
Yeah, it's true.
And when he visits, is he on his own? Is there anyone with him?
They do remark that he's on his own. The first time he arrived, he came with a man who had he came dressed as a solicitor.
Mm-hmm. At this point, do I think I can put two and two together with who this is? I'm not quite sure.
Oh, I think that by now, I mean, you've been on the case almost a week, 2 weeks. Yeah, I would say that it's definitely likely that you can put it together.
So I suppose I'll ask, you know, what was this, the foreign gentleman? What was his kind? What was his manner?
Let me see. Let me think here. Would you be talking? I guess I'll ask you. Would you have looked to speak with a member of the kitchen, whether they be a lady or a man? Would it have mattered?
I think probably. Let me just think. Certainly somebody who would be serving at table. I suppose that it depends on whether they only have whether the scullery maids and that stay in the kitchen. I'd need to speak to somebody who would actually be serving at table and who would be, you know, or serving drinks or something like that. So
so it'd probably be a male member of staff.
I would think probably, not necessarily, but I think probably.
So he'd probably remark that this gentleman has a very strange air about him. He's well versed in etiquette as far as knowing the proper way to eat. He speaks properly. He's very well refined in that regard. But he seems to come to the house of his own accord. There is no set schedule for knowing when he arrives or when he goes. And that, they remark, is quite strange.
And does he enter into lengthy private conversations with Ernest?
Indeed, both of them sometimes. When he speaks with the lady of the house, it is always with her husband present.
Hmm.
They're never together in private.
Well, yes, that would be most untoward. All right, okay, I'll bring that in, bear that in mind, and I'll just, I'll keep my eye on the house as well. And, if I see either Esther or Ernest kind of coming and going, and just kind of try and get an eye to them, their state of mind.
You probably get Ernest rather than Esther at this point. You would get him coming and going from their house and then his business, which he does have an office in central London. The timber business that he's a part of is pretty well to do. They do a fair amount of businesses. He's fairly well off.
Okay, so I assume that he just has offices which are more for the kind of more, I suppose, administrative, for want of a better word, side of things, and the actual timber business, the mills and so forth, they're in various places around the country.
Yep, that would be correct.
Okay, and there's, he I suppose his firm would deal with the shipping and all that kind of thing. I would like to look into this firm, into its finances, into how well or badly it's doing, and whether there's been any fluctuation in its finances over the last kind of month or two.
Okay, yeah. I guess where would you look into it at, as far as just the business papers, or?
Yeah, I think that's probably where I'd start. Yeah, and stock exchange and that kind of thing.
A bit of investigation into the stock exchange and some of the papers say that the business has been pretty steady as far as its holdings go. It seems to be doing well. There has not been a major uptick or downtick in anything that it's doing.
Okay. So he seems to be financially secure. So maybe that's not necessarily what's preying on his mind. Have there been any large orders of late?
None as of late.
None that I can tell. Right, okay.
So, dive over to Madame Davina. The evening of this event, you are, I would imagine, preparing your best clothes. You're in preparatory for such an event. You know that many people probably arrive by coach. How would she angle herself towards her arrival? Like, how is she going to get there? How would she, when she arrives, in what state will she be in?
She would likely hire a car to take her. And she knows that you don't have to dress a certain way to be able to read someone's fortune truly, but that doesn't mean that you have to play the part. And so she would put on some long, flowing, many layers, dangling jewelry. Her hair would be wrapped up in a headscarf so that she looks the part.
Sure. I mean, part of it, I would imagine, for her is also understanding that many people will look at her, and so she must avail herself to appear as they would think she should.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm going for. There may be the slight, as she walks, you would hear the kind of jingling of the like coins that have been adorned on some of her articles of clothing and the mini bracelets that she's wearing.
Yes, it's the art of the pantomime for you.
Yes.
So you get into all of your theatric and you get dropped off in the front of the estate. So we'll say that it's about 6 p.m. There are several autos that are dropping people off, or you even see a couple of carriages, which are still used during the period, because obviously not everybody has an auto.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some really grandiose Victorian style carriages that are still trotting around the London area. But you've secured yourself the name of the person that you need to speak with at the door. That is your one in, as you do not have a formal invitation.
Okay.
And so the gentleman at the door that you need to speak with is Owen. You know that Owen is part of the staff here. Owen knows one of your friends in the marketplace. They have had a few drinks together. That's the most polite way to put it. And over time, she developed a relationship with him, and he developed a relationship with her, which neither two of them talk about.
Okay.
So Owen is your target of choice to get you into the facility, this estate, this grandiose place. I would imagine that you would be you'd be rather eager to get in to make sure that you're inside to be mm-hmm. a part of this grand group of occultists and seers and diviners.
Yes.
So then I would ask, in turn, Aidan, where would you be positioned during that sort of night, evening, as it were?
I think probably I would be across the road, maybe in an alleyway or something like that, wearing a heavy overcoat and some sort of hat to keep the rain off my head, and just kind of watching and waiting, seeing who's coming, seeing who's going in the shadows.
The woman who's gotten out of this car that has arrived is truly someone who differs clothing-wise from anyone else who's arrived at this point. And that's saying something, because you have really seen some creative outfits. That's the best way to put it. And the lady that gets out of this auto, probably 15 yards at most. You're just across the street there, being carefully set to be able to watch the front of the house. She's done up far differently than anything that you've seen in London society papers.
I take it I'll recognize who it is then.
You might. You're paying pretty close enough attention, so I would say yeah. You probably notice.
I might have guessed she'd be here. If there's a lot of people about, I mean, I'd quite like to make myself known to her, but that's going to involve me revealing the fact that I'm lingering and lurking. So,
You're a fairly smart individual. You have some cover from the autos that are arriving. And so it's not that there's no foot traffic anywhere else here in this part of the city. So you could probably slip in through the traffic here and look as if, oh, you just came out of one of these cars that are stopping.
I think that's probably what I'll do. I'll just wait for a car to drive past, and then use it as a little bit of cover to walk across the street. And then as I do so, I will stumble very slightly as I'm walking past this lady in the fancy clubber, and a bump against her, and then sort of make as if I'm just somebody who's crossed the street and is carrying along their way, and say, oh, do beg your pardon. Sorry, clumsy me. Oh, it's yourself.
Oh, it is quite all right. Oh, hello, it is you.
You, going to a party?
Yes, I am indeed. I believe I am on some sort of guest list. Are surprised to see you in attendance here?
Oh no, I'm just on my way home. Just passing by. Looks like a fancy do, eh?
Yes, indeed, but I believe I must be finding doorman that is to let me in.
Oh, aye, of course. I'll let you away on then. Nice to see you.
Yes, it is nice to see you again as well.
Whose party is it then?
Oh, well, you don't know?
Is it the... Oh, aye, this is the Beatons' house, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, very fancy. Very fancy indeed. I'll not hold you up any longer. You have a nice night now. See you again.
Yes, I certainly hope so. And Madame Davina's a little bit suspicious of this bumping into encounter with Aidan Moore. Yes. They haven't always had the most pleasant of background of relationships, so...
Oh, do tell.
Well, he did maybe try to push her out of town a time or two.
Well, I did arrest you.
he may be the reason I had to leave London the first time. Find it quite interesting that a man of the law would be here at this party where all of these mystics and occultists are going to be gathering.
I mean, he's certainly not in uniform.
Stumbling into the party.
And it wasn't, it wasn't Aidan that had you thrown out of town. It was it was the police force. he wasn't their sole representative in the city.
Sheriff Nottingham. Yes, the details. Yes. Okay, so Davina, if you're going to continue on towards the door.
Yes.
I suppose then my question is, if Aidan stands pat there or continues on through the street as if he's, you know, just kind of walking home, as he said.
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't really have any reason to do anything else. I take it I haven't seen any sign of this fella that...
You have not as of yet, but you do... You did see earlier today that you could see through the some of these windows that are here on the first floor that the lady of the house, you assume, has been making quite a fuss over the overall setup. She's been in and out of the drawing room now where they're going to have this special event. She's been in and out probably 6 or 7 times. And so she's paying quite a lot of attention to it. And you would have picked up on that probably... one of the first things, major things that you've seen. She's sent several members of staff in and out of the room to adjust something or to change something or to move a piece of furniture. It's as if she's got a lot of energy balled up in this event.
I don't know that I can really talk my way into this event.
Aidan, you turn to go up the street. And I'd like you to give me a spot hidden roll.
Yeah, I can do that.
You won't need one for this for Madame Divine because you're going to see it pass right by you. So, Madame Davina, you see a large carriage pass you on the left as you're walking up the horseshoe-shaped, circle-ish-shaped drive here.
Mm-hmm.
It is a Victorian carriage, beautiful, carried forward by 4 black horses. And out of it steps a man with a top hat and a nice black jacket. And exceedingly smooth, tanned skin. Spike, how'd Aidan do?
I'm just telling you. So, Aidan's got 50, spot hidden. Not as eagle-eyed as Mr. Fraser is, that's for sure. I got a hard success, I've got 23.
There you go. So you turn to go up the street, and what gets your head to turn a bit is the noise from the horses as they turn into this, back into this estate. Now, again, many carriages have come and gone in the time that you've been standing there. Many of them have been quite elegant. But the gentleman that steps out of this is unmistakable. And what you spot is someone who, like many people here in London, don't exactly fit into the normal Londoner template. Madame Davina, this gentleman steps out probably no more than 10 feet from you. And it's like the god Apollo steps out of it. He's out of central casting. But he is just drop dead gorgeous. He puts the hat on. He corrects his posture a bit with just a slight move to the left. It's almost as if he got out of the carriage too fast and he knows it. And so he's playing up the fact that he's a little off kilter, and he moves his head and just gives you a bright smile and then tips his hat to you.
Madam. And I will smile. And
he turns back to the carriage and shuts the door very carefully. And he begins striding towards the front door. As he does, he veers a bit to the right towards you and says, "Excuse me," he takes his hat off. "Do you require an escort?"
"Why, that would be lovely, yes."
"Oh." He extends his arm.
"A lovely lady needs a fine gentleman escort."
"I shall hope to prove to be that." He sets his hat back on top of his head.
But I'll loop my arm around his.
He exudes a cologne scent.
Okay.
It's like a musk. It's a deep male cologne.
Is it? I imagine it's not off-putting.
No,
just
no.
Strong. Just it's nice.
It's exactly the opposite, actually.
Mm. Yeah, so inhale deeply.
It's very on-putting. That's the thing. It's strange for you because it's like, that's a really nice cologne. I would like to smell more. That's kind of what your brain does a little bit.
Yeah.
And he kind of measures his gait to make sure that he's not walking too fast or too slow for you.
Mm-hmm.
And you begin marching-ish towards the door.
If he easily goes inside or gets inside because he's known, then I won't need to let my contact know who I am.
So you'd gotten the description of Owen and you see him at the front door.
Okay.
And he knows likely what you are dressed in. And so he gets ready to say something and he sees who you're with and he just kind of gets this really like dumb look on his face.
Yeah. I wink.
And so given the hard spot hidden rule, Aidan, you see that happen. You see him escort her in, and you, with the hard part of it, also see that the staff seem to look at either one of the two of them in a really strange manner. Like something happened there that is not right.
Okay. All right, okay. I shall write that down in my little notebook. Yeah, I will. I'll have to speak to the staff later on because they're going to be. Now is not an opportunity to do so. Is there anybody else still arriving? There's still people arriving.
Well, there are definitely still people arriving.
Right, okay. This is where I wish I'd put some points in disguise. I'm not really dressed for the occasion. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to make my way across to the servant's entrance, to the rear of the building. Where it probably leads straight into the kitchens or into a mudroom or something like that, and take off my coat and hat as I do so, and see if I can find somebody, maybe the head cook or something like that, or maybe an underbutler or something like that, and say, "Oh, I'm terribly sorry, I'm late. I was taken on just for the do tonight. I'm to serve drinks and the parlor or whatever. Sorry, I had a hell of a job finding the place."
You see the, we'll say it's an under butler. That's probably the cooks are probably just a little too busy. Mm. Not that they're not always busy. You see this man a bit of a stuffed shirt. He seems a little bit impressed with himself. He says, "Well, go and get changed." He points to a closet just at the far end of the room.
Thank you very much.
Go and put something on and get over here. And we have a job to do.
Sorry. I'll get something right now. Sorry about that again. Sorry. And I'll go over and I'll see if I can find some suitable attire in the servants' room that will fit me.
Yeah. Yeah, you managed to find a coat that fits, and they've even got we've got quite a collection of clothing in here. So if you wanted to probably swap out shoes, they might have in here as well. Gloves,
probably need a wing collar and tie and a jacket, and if I can get a pair of black shoes on. I'm not wearing smart gear when I'm out in the streets. So yeah, I'll just try and kind of grab whatever clothing that. I can that's in the room that might fit me. Thank the stars that there is something there and I wasn't expected to bring my own. So, and then go back and find this chap again and say, "Right, I hope that's all right, sir. I'm ready now. Where do you want me to go?"
He picks at you a little bit to straighten a few things out there. Head over there and prepare with the drink trays. They're going to start bringing them out soon.
Righto, sir. Righto. Will do. I'll make myself over and grab a tray and get loaded up with drinks and
you kind of get the timing that guests are beginning to guests have started to arrive, and so basically you do what any member of staff, any member of wait staff would do, is you head out with a tray of drinks, you pass them out, you collect the empties, and you head back to the kitchen. It's fairly simple, straightforward work. And the nice part about that is it gives Aidan an amazing amount of opportunities to see who's here, what they're doing. So inside the main entranceway, this gentleman turns to you, Madame Davina, and says, he takes his hat off and then hands his hat to a member of staff who's waiting nearby. I am Alexander Fitzgerald. He kind of bows a bit to you. Not full by any means, but definitely a courtesy for sure.
It is a pleasure to make your acquaintance. My name is Madame Davina.
Madame Davina. So, it's my understanding that there's going to be quite the revelation here tonight. Are you part of that?
Why, yes, I am, and I certainly do hope so.
Wonderful. Wonderful. The Beaton Estate is full of wonderful people. I hope, hopefully, you'll be able to assist dear Esther with her heart's desire.
Is our mystic ability something of an interest to you? Perhaps later I could read your palm?
I would like that. I would be very interested to see what you might find.
Yes, I would be interested as well, I think.
Well, please, he gestures towards the room where you can see some of the guests are beginning to collect and get served drinks.
Yes, we should make our way in.
So you notice a couple of things about just being around him. He tends to draw eyes fairly readily. And it's not just the ladies who are here that are getting that. It's the men as well. It almost happens every time he steps towards a person, he gets their glances. The staff come to him first with drinks. You get a lot of just preferential treatment when you're around him. But he doesn't necessarily stay close to you the entire time. He finds a spot for you to relax. He makes sure that you have a drink and then says, I have some matters to attend to here, but I shall return. Worry not.
Of course, of course. Do I recognize any other mystics here that I've maybe met in the past?
You look around the room. There's a couple here so far. You know that there is a card reader over there. Her name is Henrietta. And she's likely just a mundane card reader, but she's got quite a method of reading cards. It's very dramatic. She kind of gets balled up into the entire experience of what draws people in. You see that there is a another gentleman over there that reads bones. You've seen him down in Soho more than a few times, reading, you know, bones about the war, and someone brings, you know, a piece of a finger bone out, and he's able to douse what they were last doing. Whether it's true or not is up to anyone's guess. But yeah, the room is starting to fill with probably four or five people that do what you do. Supposedly, you're supposed to be up to 20, although you're not sure how many people will show up. You do see, actually both of you would see, because at this point Aiden's going to hit the floor with drinks. You would both see gentlemen. You see Ernest Beaton. He arrives through another doorway, strides, and shakes Alexander's hand. They have a quiet few words with one another, and then Alexander goes out the door that Ernest came in. The man in the house doesn't seem to be... He seems to be very reserved. Kind of both get that from his expression. He's happy to have people in the house. He's happy to have guests, but it's a very... He's very reserved. He doesn't talk to a whole lot of people. He's here as almost... It appears as if he's almost... It's perfunctory. He's here because he has to be here, which is probably true of a lot of societal functions at this point.
I'm going to kind of mill around the area where everybody's kind of gathered and chatting, and to see if I can pick up any snippets of information. Do I see this chap when I'm here, or is he headed off before I get out?
He's heading off when you enter the room. So you would see him probably as he's having left Ernest's side. It looks like maybe there was a conversation there.
Mm-hmm.
But you do see him walk out of the room.
Where does he seem to be heading towards?
Deeper into the house.
Okay.
Definitely not a guest area.
Okay.
So he's going somewhere where you know, probably deeper into the house, whether it be a hallway or whether it be another larger family room or that sort of thing. Okay. So I feel it's necessary to give Madame Davina a spot hidden roll to see if her friend, the former
police... That's what
police
I was going
to
ask about.
I'm going to try and not to be spotted by her, but you know, that might not work out for me.
I don't know that you should roll stealth. You could, I suppose, although... If you're actually being stealthy, it would totally give away you being aware.
No, I think I'm just going to mill around, but try and keep my back to her if I can.
Sure.
I rolled a 33 over 25, so I do not spy him.
The staff here are nice. You're left with the with a glass of champagne, the lingering cologne smell, and well, I guess what do you do when? Do you have anything you set up to do what you do at all? Or is there any sort of staging that you do for it? Do you pick out a specific chair, or do you have the staff bring over anything?
I would probably like to get set up in a part of the room that would be prominent enough that I would be seen. I don't really want to be in the background. So I would try to eye a spot and kind of linger around there. I might... talk with Henrietta, just people that I would mingle with, people that I already know, and I may also offer brief readings to some of the folks that are around here, just you know, get my name out in the community so that they, rather than where I am one in many, I kind of want to have a couple of one-on-one interactions with people that look like they have some cash. Not for cash right now. This is just the taste. So that the taste is free.
Yep. You're just trying to whet people's appetites.
Yes, exactly. So I may answer a couple of questions.
You find a position, you find a chair that is relatively open. There's a few people by it, but what draws you to it is directly behind it, probably a good 5 to 10 feet behind this chair, there is a massive grandfather clock. And it gives you... the feeling, anyway, of having something behind you, which is much larger. So you get kind of the you get a bit of a grandiose stage if you would just sit here. And so, as you begin whetting appetites of those who are interested, I suppose I would ask, what method are you going to use? Is it a tea leaf thing, or are you going to do something more subtle, or I guess how would you work?
No, I think in this sense, I'll probably be genuine in the sense, and I might do some item readings. And so, you know, people tend to have family heirloom items, things like that. So I may ask to hold something of theirs and be genuine in this. I'm not trying to put on too much of a show. I don't think that this is the setting to be too terribly theatrical, but I want to get people interested.
I suppose I might let you weaponize psychology.
Okay. I mean, I did that. That is why I put 60 into psychology as a fortune teller.
So why don't you give me a psychology roll to see if you can kind of cajole and convince people over a long term? It's not so much a direct persuasion.
Yeah.
It's more of a come sit and let me wrap my words around your brain and convince you of something.
Roll a 44 under 60.
Okay. Yeah, you have two or three people who are kind of now around the chair who are interested in either hearing or are interested in interacting with you. And so I guess at this point then, I'm going to offer Aidan that same spot hidden roll just to see if he's now realized that, oh, yes, of course, Madame Davina is doing her work here.
Okay. That might actually prove quite useful. That's a big old fail.
Okay. You go back to the kitchen, and it seems the staff here is starting to work on finishing several trays of what look like appetizers or smaller cakes. They're working up some food items in the kitchen, and the wait staff is unloading empty glasses and reloading back up with fresh liquid ammunition, as we would call it. And so that's what you're doing. about 15 minutes or so pass. There's a definite hush that falls over the crowd. It can be heard even in the difference in tone. It can be heard even from the staff in the kitchen as the lady of the house arrives. Right? So Eddie or Esther arrives. Esther Beaton arrives. And she is dressed in something that even you, Madame Divine, would say would be progressive. It's very Parisian. It is not a London piece of clothing, you don't think. There's a nice shawl. There's an elegant dress. She's not by any means, she's in her 40s at this point. So it's not anything untoward, but it is definitely trendy. That's the best way to put it. Some of the staff here, you can tell, they don't stop. They don't stare, but there is a slight... a slight correction of path to just, oh, okay, so this happened. I didn't realize that that was going to happen. But the crowd welcomes her. There's probably now 30 or so people here. Miranda, your character probably counts 7 or so talented members of the occultish and divination crowd, nowhere near the 20 that you had heard.
I had almost expected as much would be the case.
And Aidan, while you're behind getting reloaded with drinks, you hear a member of staff whisper to another, did you see what she's come on? She's wearing? She's come out in that? It's very brief. It's very quiet. But it's something that happens behind the closed door.
Sorry, who are they referring to?
They're referring to what sounds like the lady of the house,
yeah,
Esther
that's
Beaton.
What I was thinking, yeah. If I can find a moment where there's a distraction going on in the room, maybe this is it.
Oh, definitely.
I'm going to try and slip away to see if I can see where this Fitzgeorge fellow went.
Sure. Yeah, if you want to slip away, this would easily be the best time because all eyes literally are on Esther Beaton.
Okay.
You do so. Hand your tray of drinks off and or set it down.
Slip off down the corridor and quietly and carefully make my way through the house to see if I can hear him. Do I see, is Ernest in the company of all the gathered guests and that, or is he?
Yeah, he is. He's actually, as this social occurrence is happening, he is waiting for his wife to finish walking across the room to him. And it would be fairly easy to tell for both of you that he is not. He was not prepared for her to wear what she's wearing. Not prepared in the least. She looks like something out of The Follies. I'll just put it that way.
Mutton dressed.
If you're familiar with... but yeah, you're able to slip away, Aidan. The rest of the house, for the most part, is fairly not well lit, but it's actually a bit dim, as most of the lighting has been preserved for... the area for guests.
Okay.
So I guess my question is, in this two-story manor, where would you be heading off to?
Well, I'm initially going to head the direction that Fitzgeorge headed. And kind of try and get my bearings in the house proper as to what's likely to be behind doors. So I'm going to make my way along the corridor, basically listening at doors. To see if I can.
Okay. You want to give me a listen roll and see what you might pick up?
Absolutely. Okay. No, that's a fail.
Okay. Would you like to push?
Why not?
Yeah.
So at the minute I've been kind of tippy-toeing around, but I'm actually going to put my ear to the door. See if I can hear anything. Just move along to something that I think might be, you know, an office, you know, a library or a study or something like that. And just kind of put my ear to the door, a door that's closed, because I'll be able to hear through sort of doors that are a crack open.
Sure.
Oh dear. I did not succeed. My pushed listener. Oh.
So you cup your ear a bit to the door, which you think is maybe the library. At least from the doors you've seen so far, this is probably the library. and you hear a voice in the beyond there say, "To be perfectly honest, Thomas, I don't care. I don't care how long it takes. I don't care how much it costs. We have a specific goal in mind. And we're going to have what we are supposed to have. It's ours by right of birth." And you, Aidan, hears the what sounds like a metal on metal sound, almost as if something, someone set something down rather heavy, and it spooks you, and you reach out to steady yourself, and you accidentally push open the library door, and beyond the library door there is a beautiful carpet. There is a wide set of bookcases that line this rather, quite frankly, average-sized library. It's not something like you've seen in some of the other maybe larger houses. And at the end of this library, there is a small circular table. And on that table, there is a phone. And the phone has a man's hand on it. And he turns to you, and you see the man you've been looking for staring back at you.
I'm sorry. I was trying to find
I scrumple my hair and act like I'm very, very drunk.
This is the facilities.
Oh, no, dear boy. This is not the facilities. He stands straight up and turns. Did you need help?
No, I'm fine. I'll find my way. Thank you very much.
I'm going to stumble out into the corridor.
Okay, I'm going to need... I think it's got to be some sort of social role here.
Yeah.
Whether it be a persuade, maybe, or whether it be... It's definitely not... Well, I suppose I would take either persuade or fast talk, because you are going a bit rapid fire there.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to go for persuade, because it's what I've got points in.
Fair enough.
I can do that. So yeah, I just kind of pull my tie to one side and my dishevel my hair a bit and just make myself look like I'm some idiot who's can't find his way around.
What, open a library door?
I'll spend 3 points of luck to make that a success.
Okay. Well, you think it's fairly believable. Well, you turn and kind of move from the door and probably move down one of the hallways to get away from what just happened. While your hearing was not as keen before, you can definitely hear the footsteps walking across the library towards you. So you know he may be coming your way at some point.
Right, okay, I'm just going to scalp her.
So, Madame Davina, if you would, as the man and woman of the house are now available, and your hosts are here, I suppose, how would you wait for them to make some sort of announcement, or would you launch into your abilities?
Theatrics. I would wait, because I don't fully know what they had planned. And while there's only 7 of us here, I'm not entirely sure what sort of stage that they will be setting for us. Mm-hmm. And I would hate to rob them of that.
Okay.
Edie obviously has something in mind.
She does. So it takes her probably a couple of minutes to say her hellos, to acknowledge people. Maybe a minute or so. And it's from that she takes kind of center of the drawing room here, this center room, and says, "Thank you all so much for coming. I greatly appreciate it. I hope you're enjoying yourself. My mother was a wonderful woman, and lo, these many years since her passing, I have wondered, I have questioned whether or not she would be able to speak with me after she passed. You see, while many are unaware of it, my family has for some time believed that those souls which pass may still yet speak to those who are present, and that my mother was one of these people. And so I have asked many of the finest of London's spiritual society to attend me this evening, so we might bring forth her spirit and she might speak with us one last time. And so she turns to the collected group of occultists, spiritualists, and etc., and says, which one of you has the talents which may unlock her voice?
I believe that I may.
Mm-hmm. She turns to you. Truly?
Possibly.
Well, come then. Tell us who you are, and how will you bring her forth?
Yes, my name is Madame Davina. I have the gift of sight. If you have an object of your late mother's, perhaps I could use it to channel her energy and she could speak through me.
Perhaps. She goes to her brooch on her dress and removes this emerald and diamond encrusted brooch. It's in a beautiful shape of what appears to be a lion. At least that's what you think the face is. And she very carefully and gingerly extends her hand out towards you with this brooch.
And I'll take it carefully with as much care as she is showing it.
Yeah.
I will show it as well. Are there specific questions you wish to ask of your mother?
Yes, I want to know. She kind of turns her head down towards the floor for a moment and then steps a bit closer.
I'll lean in so that she doesn't have to be loud.
I want to know if I was supposed to marry Ernest or not.
Very interesting. And your mother would know that?
My mother was there when it was arranged. She says almost just a little bit louder, but not too much.
Yes, I will see if I can find your mother's voice here.
So, Aidan, where are you heading to? Back to the party?
Yeah, I think I'll head back down to the kitchens. If I go into the party, it's just going to cause a bit of a kerfuffle. Now, my first thought was to pretend I'd lost my way as a servant, and I'm rather thinking that would have been possibly a better strategy than the one I adopted, because it's rather left me in a position where I can't carry it forward. So I think I'm just going to have to make myself scarce. Okay. In fact, what I'll try and do is, if I can hear him, I'm going to try and see if I can go into a room that might be an empty room. If I can find a water closet or something to hide myself in, that would be perfect.
Oh, yeah.
And just kind of close the door behind me and listen at the door to hopefully hear his footsteps go past.
Yep. Yeah, it's easily done. Finding yourself a water closet is easy to do. And sure enough, probably a good maybe 30 seconds or so later, you hear the shoes on the hardwood floors here walk past the water closet, and you can tell that they're going back towards the party.
Right, okay. So I'll kind of give it a couple of minutes and then make my way back down the corridor again. I guess I'll probably be... I think he'll recognize me again if he sees me, won't he? I think I'll need to keep myself in the shadows a bit now, if I can.
So back to the party, Madame Davina, you have this brooch, mm-hmm. and you you have what the request is.
Yes.
I suppose. Why don't you tell us how you're going to go about?
Well, I feel like that question gives me a point on the horizon to aim for. So I'm hoping I can channel my energy and focus on this brooch to possibly glean information about what happened the day that the marriage was arranged. Possibly whether her mother felt positively about it or negatively. This could be something that, you know, her father arranged but her mother didn't want. So I kind of want to glean how her mother felt about the arrangement, if I can reach that far back into the past of this item and its owner.
Okay. So why don't you give me a psychometry roll?
one. That one was jacked. Okay. 46 under 60.
Okay. So that's, what is it? 1d 10 rounds it takes you. So, so you're going to get an answer in 3 rounds. So you begin holding this brooch and feeling the vibrational energy it gives off and kind of mentally and spiritually search out the voice of Eddie's mother.
Yes.
Or Edie's mother. And you feel your thumbs just almost rub along the side of the emerald because it's such a large stone in comparison to all the rest of them. Mm-hmm. You feel that there's almost a heartbeat inside of it. There's some sort of feeling that comes from it. It's a very warm feeling at first. It feels you with a positive connection to that point on the horizon that you talked about. After a few moments, your senses are again, because your eyes, I assume, are closed for concentration. Your senses are flooded again by this, the arrival of this smell, this cologne again. And you hear a voice just in the distance because you're concentrating very hard on the brooch and finding her mother. You hear, is she doing it? Is she finding it? And you hear Eddie's voice say, please just give her a moment. And you connect with something through this brooch. You get a picture in your mind of two very unhappy people. One of them is an older woman. You get that matronly sense of them being an older woman. The other one is a much younger woman. And you get a flash of two men at odds with one another. And one meeting a very final sort of end. And Esther being left with the remnants or left with something. Or you get the emotion that this younger woman is had to settle or been given a task. It feels almost like a punishment rather than what you feel like a marriage or wedding should be. And so there's a lot of emotion tied to the memory that you get. Now, so you don't actually hear any words by any means, but that's the flood of emotions that you get.
Yes. I imagine this to be not when I use my ability that I'm not getting direct answers. It is up for interpretation always.
Absolutely. It's as accurate as reading a horoscope.
Yeah, exactly.
But those are the symbols and the images that you get from the brooch. And you can see kind of as you begin to come out of this somewhat trance-like state that there are a lot of eyes on you.
So Edie was kind of not secretive because we're in a room full of people, but she was quiet about her question.
Oh, yeah.
I think Madame Davina would. She feels a bit sad. This is kind of a sad story. So she, when she rises, when she sits up, she would have kind of a sad look on her face, but she would pull Edie close. I would say into the hug of a friend, and would whisper to her, "Your mother did not want this life for you. She wanted you to find love, real love, and purpose in your life. She feel similar to you on that day. She did not want this for you."
She begins to shake and quiver a bit in your grasp. It's you get a bit of reluctance when you go to get as close as a friend in that space with her. Mm-hmm. But she kind of collapses into your arms in an almost uncontrollable way. You're worried that she may faint, and you're not necessarily the largest person in the world.
No, I'm pretty weak.
So she loses a bit of her bodily control, and you see that Alexander grabs her in a very proper manner to keep her from falling.
Yes.
And there's a gasp from the crowd. And as he turns her over, You can see that Edie's eyes have gone completely milk white, and her body is now paling as Alexander lays her onto the floor. You hear Ernest from across the room. My God, what's happened? So, Aidan, as you're sitting in the water closet, just trying to figure out what your next step is, as you're thinking, I can just duck out of this house and, you know, fight to, you know, live to fight another day.
I should have been a farmer.
You hear, just of course, the most gentlemanly English way, some social faux pas has happened in the next room, and it is bad.
Yeah, I'm going to try and get out and see if I can observe it whilst remaining unobserved by
Fitzgeorge. Yeah, not but a few steps down the hallway, you can get a beady eye into the drawing room and kind of look through the crack of a door. Man, it looks like there's a crowd has surrounded the lady of the house and Madame Davina, and it looks like the lady of the house is on the floor. She's laying on her back. Something terrible may have happened.
Is anyone here a doctor?
People start shouting for doctors. Everybody hears that. You see Alexander like put his hand like on part of her neck, and he almost seems to try to, he seems like he's touching her face quite a bit, and he's like touching parts of her arm.
Does it look like he's trying to do something medical to assist her?
He looks like he might have some knowledge of first aid. He looks like he's trying to find a pulse.
Right. Okay. Then. All right. That's my priority at the minute, is just to see if she's actually, if there is anybody putting their hand up saying I'm a doctor, I can look after her. But
no one has yet. You see that the Henrietta begins dealing cards very quickly, like on her table, just in a complete and utter fear, and she's like, no, 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 and the lights go out in the drawing room. Pure black. And you hear on the wind outside a howl.
I'm going to wait for a moment, come close my eyes, and then reopen them, because that will get my eyes accustomed to the darkness.
Yep. So, quite a bit of rattling starts up in the drawing room. So whether it's cups and saucers, or whether it's a rattle from silverware or spoons, you start hearing things move in there. And two points of light appear in the room, and they are floor level and set together. And they are the glowing white eyes of Esther Beat. And now you roll sand.
So I take it that nobody's like struck a match in the room. Nobody's got like
not yet
cigarettes or matches like that.
Are we both rolling sand?
You absolutely are both rolling sand.
Okay. Should have stayed in the toilet.
Oh, Lily. I've never murdered anyone before, so I rolled the 86 over 70.
Okay.
Oh, you have a 70, Sam, do you? I don't have a 70, Sam.
No, you don't.
So, however, I rolled a 02.
So, Aiden's brain is going to allow him to play it off like that is clearly someone's got a torch in there. There's got to be something.
Right.
That's the moon. Unfortunately, Madame Davina, you are not as lucky. You lose 2 points of sand. As you stare down at your, well, at the reason why you're here, Esther stands up in a single swift motion. She more rises to her feet, and you see her arms in this elegant but yet provocative dress. Her arms come up and these wonderful sleeves extend down, and she kind of extends her hands out as if to push the world and everything in it away from her, and the room continues to rattle. At this point, people begin fleeing the room. And luckily, Aidan is quick enough to step away from the doors as several bodies begin hurtling their way towards you.
The light in Esther's eyes, I take it it's not like illuminating the room, it's just like two little bricks of light.
Imagine an opalescent sort of diffused light, right? Mm-hmm. So it's, I would almost say like light behind frosted glass.
Yeah.
It's probably half again as bright as a torch of the era. So it's not lighting up the room per se, but it lights up her face and the immediate area around her upper body.
In my lookings around the house, did I happen to see a candle in a candlestick anywhere?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm going to try and grab one of those and light it so that there's some light in the room and just kind of hold it up and see what's going on. And I also want to see where Fitzgeorge is, because the last thing I saw before the lights went off was him kind of poking and prodding at her.
Mm-hmm. Getting real light into the room with this candle to bring up the light as people begin to flee, Fitzgeorge is gone.
Okay.
He's not on the floor. He's not next to Ernest. He's not here.
What's Ernest doing?
He's moving towards his wife, and actually moving towards Madame Davina, because he's probably concerned that she may have done something to his wife.
Yeah, I think I'm going to do the same. I'm going to put the candle down somewhere nearby, so that there's, you know, at least a little bit of light in the room, and my two hands are free, and I'm going to make my way over to to Esther, and see if she is okay, because you know. She's lying on the floor. She's now got up. She's kind of stomping about.
Yeah. You bring the natural light over to her, this raw candle flame. And the closer you get to it, the less and less her eyes seem to have that same glow.
Okay.
You get close enough, and then you see that Ernest kind of grabs her from behind, almost in a bit of a hug of sorts, like he's trying to put her arms down and keep her together. And she again looks woozy now. She looks like she's going to faint, and Ernest holds her up. God in heaven, what has happened here? Are you all right? He seems to be talking to his wife.
I'm going to head over and say, can I help at all? I've got some medical knowledge.
Are you a doctor?
I'm not a doctor, but I know a little first aid.
Oh, please, please. He gets her to a chair.
So I'll kind of take her pulse and just see if I can figure out whether she's just had a fainting fit or whether there's actually something wrong with her. Kind of, you know, look at her eyes as well, because obviously her eyes are
sure
a bit odd.
Go ahead and roll first aid for me. Yeah. And then, Madame Davina, what are you doing at this time?
I imagine that Madame Davina is in kind of a state of shock. She hasn't had someone die on her watch before or come back from the dead on her watch before. She is certainly worried that people are going to think that she killed Esther. And I imagine she's frozen, because if she stays, she'll almost certainly be accused of something. And if she leaves, she'll almost certainly be accused of something as well. So what is the lesser, I guess, being accused straight on than being accused as someone that has run away from the situation? So if I can stay and help, I will try to stay and help in some way.
Fair enough. Go ahead and give me a first aid roll then, Aaron.
I have a first aid of 55. And that's a hard success, 23.
She probably has had a bit of a faint here. You're worried that she doesn't seem to be keeping her head up. You have pulse, so it's not that she's not alive. She is.
Mm-hmm.
But you're trying to get her comfortable. They brought an ottoman over. They brought something over where she can more lie down rather than sit up. Staff have already gotten a sheet or a blanket or something to put over her.
Glass of water. And then, get us a glass of water.
Yes. Someone's gone off to fetch water as well. Ernest looks over as you're attending to his wife and says, "These past few weeks, she's just been, she's been someone different. It's, what is that, Fitzgeorge?" He seems to look about the room.
What happened to her?
"She's been awful lately about her mother and her mother's passing. She's been worried it's something to do with her mother and something that happened years ago, but I thought we were past it." He kind of throws his hands up for a moment. And
maybe it's just the stress and the strain, and she's overdone it a wee bit and had a fainting fit. I've seen that before. Meanwhile, I'm trying to figure out what's wrong with her neck.
It's just that her body's not keeping it up at this point. It's that she's unconscious, effectively.
Oh, right. So it's just kind of...
There's no rigidity to her neck. She's just kind of moving it around. And
I think what she needs is some rest for start. And I would say, Cole, do you have a family physician now?
We do.
Well, I would say give him a wee call. Do you have a telephone?
Yes, we have a telephone.
Why don't you go and give your physician a wee call? Get him to come and attend to her. I'll make sure that she's comfortable here while you do that.
Thank you. He looks at you for just another second before he walks out and says, "Are you a member of staff? I don't remember."
"Oh, they called me in because they needed more staff. There was a fellow off sick, so they called me in."
"Hey, all right. Fair enough. Well, good you're here." He nods to you and walks out of the room.
Right. And I see. So she's unconscious. And I'm going to kind of look around the room to see if there's anybody left in the room.
Mr. Moore, is there anything that I can do to help?
What happened? What happened? Did she just faint?
I'm not sure. It did seem like she fainted or possibly... had some sort of seizure episode. She asked me if her mother, if she was meant to marry her husband, and I don't believe that she was, based on what I felt. And so I told her that her mother was not happy with the arrangement.
Well, as far as I can tell from what her husband was saying, her mother's dead.
Well, yes, her mother is dead. Yes, that was the point of the night here.
So, her... Right, okay. Or this is one of those things where... right, okay.
Yes, Mr. Moore.
And are you sure? Are you sure about this? You're not putting us on now.
Oh, no, not in this case. I am definitely sure. I would not harm a woman's spirit unless... it was absolute truth.
So, do you think that's what caused her conniptions? Like, is that...
Yes, it did seem like it was quite a blow, but that doesn't explain everything. That doesn't explain how she came back up in the glowing eyes.
Ach, that... The glowing eyes. I saw that. That was just... It must have been just like the moonlight reflecting coming through the window or something. I did see that,
no,
that young
Moore.
Fella. That young fella. See the chap that you came in with? He was poking and prodding at her. I thought he was just taking her pulse, but...
No, I'm concerned that he may have been up to something as well. Perhaps he was feeling around her neck a lot. Does she have all of her jewelry that she had before?
I don't know what she had before. I'll see if she wearing a necklace or a bracelet or anything.
She's wearing a necklace. She's actually wearing a necklace that doesn't... I mean, depending on how deep you look... She's wearing a necklace that doesn't match any of the other finery that she has.
Can I remember if she was wearing this before the fainting spell or if something has changed? Because I was in pretty close proximity to her.
Yeah, I'd say that you can probably remember it. Yeah, you would not remember her having this on before she passed out.
She did not have this necklace before. He may have slipped it on her for some reason.
Why would he put a necklace on a woman after... I'm going to have she's unconscious just now. I'm just going to very, very swiftly but gently take a look at this necklace.
Sure, absolutely.
No, we have to take it off. Take it off. If you want to look at it, that's fine, but take it off of her first.
So, yeah, I mean, I'll I will first of all look to see if there's anything on it, and then I probably will take it off of it. It's just a plain. Yeah. No.
It's not. It's actually, it's a series of swirls. So it almost reminds you of something a bit Celtic, Aidan. Although the swirls are in a different sort of pattern.
Could I make an occult roll to see if...
You could. Mm-hmm. Actually, if you're... I mean, if you're holding it up, Madame Davina can make an occult roll as well.
Yeah, okay. I will.
So, I have not got much in occult. But,
A 19 under 45, ooh, so very hard. Nice.
Okay.
Wow.
So, let's see... A 24 under 25.
Ah, very good. So this for both of you is likely something far more Eastern than anywhere close to England. This is something that you think is maybe Babylonian or Syrian, perhaps. It doesn't truck with anything here. And as far as your knowledge of the occult goes, this is more like a, it's not a symbol. You have first associated it with the symbol of endearment, but after looking at it a little bit more closely, you would associate it with a symbol of, almost like a symbol of locking. It's a very strange, it's like a finality, right? So it's something that you would see in occultic circles to perhaps end a spell. Or an enchantment, or a working. It would be something that would be done at the end to kind of close it and lock it down.
I'm going to look at Madame Davina and say, you know what this is?
I have some ideas. It seems like you've been doing your studying as well.
Aye, well, it's old, I know that, and it's not good. And I think you're right. I think we need to get it off her right now.
Take it off. Yes, take it off of her. Time is of the essence here.
So, yeah, I'm going to do that.
Okay. So I'd like you to make me a strength roll to take it off.
Okay.
Because...
Glad you're the one doing it and not me, brother.
there's no little clasp on it or something like that?
Uh-uh.
All right, nope. Okay.
There's no clasp on it.
It doesn't look like it's...
Through and through circle.
Right. Okay, this is not right. This is not right. This shouldn't even be able to go over her head. So I'll try and snap it off. Okay. Oh, lovely. That is... A 17 under my strength of 60.
Good. I'm going to make an opposed power roll for the item because it doesn't want to let go. Okay. So you pull and pull and pull, and you see, actually, because it's a long jacket, you wouldn't really see the strength in his arms, but you can tell Madame that he's probably got quite a bit of strength to him. It takes you a good 2 full inhale breaths. That first one, as you go, and then the second one, as you finally feel it give away, and it snaps with a pop in the room.
What the hell is that made of?
And you get a just absolute toxic feeling in your fingers from even holding it.
Right, I'm just going to kind of throw it across the floor. I intend to pick it up later on with like a handkerchief or something like that and put it in my pocket, but I just want to get it away from her for the moment.
Ernest comes back in.
Esther, are you okay now? Come back to us, Esther.
Her eyes flutter a bit, and you see that the milkiness of them begin to fade. You see the color of her eyes come back. What? Where am I? What's going on?
You've had a wee turn, Mrs. But you're all right now.
Oh. Ernest? You see him come from across the room. Oh, she's awake. Wonderful. The doctor's on his way. Just stay resting. We've got water here. Oh,
that's grand.
Wonderful.
The doctor will be able to look after her properly, but I think the worst of it's over now.
He turns to you, Madame Davina. What happened? What did you see?
What happened to her was not my doing, but it was that I believe it was Mr. Fitzgeorge that did this. I believe he means our family harm for some reason.
blasted man's been a cancer since he's been here. He only arrived but a few weeks ago, and she has been completely enraptured with him. I've been busy in central London, of course, with business, and she's been dealing with his strange and odd mysticism since then. She's been desperate to speak with someone who would speak with her mother, which is the reason this entire charade has gone on tonight.
Yes, it would seem that he seeks to cause her harm or possibly take advantage of her. I'm so sorry that this has happened to you, Esther.
I will call the authorities. It's all right. He seems to go back to comforting his wife. What I need is someone to hunt this man down.
Can I look at the woman lying down, look at the frilly lady, and look at Mr. Beaton, I have not been entirely honest with you, forthcoming, as it were. I'm not being employed as a servant here. I'm in the employ of Palaki's Detective Agency. We have reason to believe that this Mr. Fitzgeorge is involved in some nefarious undertakings. I can't go into the details of it because they're confidential and so forth, but we have a keen interest in him and his comings and goings and his doings and so forth. Would you mind if I asked you a few questions about him? About how you come to know him?
Certainly, at least before the doctor arrives.
So, I suppose the first question is how did you meet this man? How did you first become introduced to him?
She was having a luncheon somewhere down in central London, and there were some socialites, some of her social friends there. And evidently, this Fitzgeorge paid this luncheon a visit, and he simply wowed all of them with his foreign candor and his deep knowledge of many different subjects. Man was like a whirlwind. And after that, he was, but days later, in my house with the staff here and with her and I, speaking of how he could uncover things about her past. She has varying interests. I have no issue with those interests. They are something that keep her busy and keep her interested, and rather leave me the time to work the family business and ensure life and financial stability. You understand, of course.
Of course, I. We all need to eat.
And then it seemed that he was here every day, and it seemed that he would call on us during the weekend. He became some sort of, almost like a live-in guest. Though he never stayed here, I wouldn't allow it. Although she did ask.
But he just made himself at home, eh?
I don't think I've ever seen anything like it in my lifetime. And, to be perfectly honest, it was difficult for me to say no. The man is friendly and affable and well-mannered and all, everything someone would want in a high society friend. He said that he was in London on some business with his own family, and I don't know. We never really got into anything deeper than that. He was much more the questioner, I suppose.
Do you know where he lives?
Well, it's my understanding that he is staying somewhere in central London at one of the hotels, but I even sent some of my own people that I know close to there to check up on him and whatnot, just to make sure he was who he said he was, but they could not get a final finger or a thumb on where he actually stayed.
And who is this man? Where does he come from? Where does his money come from? Do you know anything about him?
Italy. But then he's also said that he spent time in Paris. And so it's difficult to believe what we might know about him now.
He sounds like a confidence trickster to me.
Yes, and she's walked right into it. And I with her.
Aye, well, they're very clever, these fellas. You know, they tell you what you want to hear. That's how they get their hooks into you. Isn't that right?
He looks at you, Madame Davina.
Yes, the ones that that aren't good natured and mean harm. Yes.
Oh,
Sometimes they will lie to get their way.
The frauds, the charlatans. Not like yourself. No, 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 no. You're the real McCoy.
Well, this is what I would like. Perhaps you could avail yourself if you're already looking for him, and it's clear that he's involved in something of this. Spiritualist, so these occult matters. Perhaps the two of you would pick up where you left off. Locate him. Bring him to heel, if you would.
Why? Certainly I'm looking to find the man, find out who he really is. What his game is. Because he's up to something. He's up to something, and my guess is this is all part of it. My guess is that he's playing chess, and he looks upon the likes of yourself and your good lady here as pawns in his game. Just moving you about the way he wants you. But we'll put a stop to that. Isn't that right?
Yes, I believe that I can possibly help you get into some of the circles he likely moves around in. And we cannot let someone that means others harm tarnish the good name of mystics and occultists.
That seems reasonable.
But I think the first thing that you need to do is you need to get your doctor to have a wee look at your missus here, and he will do all the medical examination and prescribe her the treatments and whatever she needs, and get her back on her feet, and she'll be right just rain in no time, I'm sure.
Very well. So he stands back up. Is that enough? Your word and my word together?
What do you think? I think so. Is there nothing else you can tell me about the man? Nothing else that you can...
I know that he said before he came to London, the last place he was in Paris. And that he was in some rather important circles there. At the university.
Wow, university in Paris, is it? Do you think he was being honest when he said that, or was that just all part of his wee charade?
No, I think he might have been honest with me, because he mentioned that he had a sister there who was in study as well.
A sister, is it? All right, okay. Well, very well, very well. Well, I'll tell you what. First thing we'll do is we'll try and find out where he lives, or where he's staying anyway. That's that. Because he must be in some hotel somewhere. There'll be records kept.
Well, madam, I'm sure that your time here may affect your potential for social callings in the future, unfortunately. I'll make sure that the papers are straight as far as your involvement here. I wouldn't want your reputation damaged by anything that this Fitzgeorge may have done.
Thank you very much, and I will do what I can to help Mr. Moore here track down this Fitzgeorge.
Good. I look forward to seeing him brought to heel, as I said.
Oh, don't you worry about that. We'll find him. I am going to, at that point, walk across to the other side of the room where I threw the necklace to, very carefully take a handkerchief out of my pocket and collect it up in the handkerchief. Put it back in my pocket and make my way over towards Madame Davina and say, if you're up to it, I think I have a wee job for you. And I hand her the necklace.
Oh, no. No.
I think that is the perfect point to end. So hopefully in the near future, we will see Madame Davina, and we will see our private investigator, Aidan Moore, again. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Horror on the Orient Express, the Prelude series, and have a wonderful day or evening, wherever you might be. We thank you for your listening ears.